Hi, hope you guys are doing well. So we are at the last part of our Blender Beginner Metaverse Creation Series thing. So in this last part, we'll be looking at placing the lights, creating the materials, animating the camera, and finally rendering. This is going to be a long video, but I think 8 parts is more than enough. So let's get started. So now that we're in Blender, the first thing I think we're going to be doing is I'm just going to make this sky transparent. Hide this sky, and we're going to move this light. This light over here, the sunlight, remember that we created. So we're just going to place it where the sun is, okay, and then we can also rotate the light by clicking R. You see this line? We're going to make it like so that it feels like the sun is pointing at them, and also change the light to orangish type of color so that it also gives the same color as the sun. Let's check it in the render view. You can see that sunlight is automatically starting to affect the area. Okay, so now the next step we're going to be doing is animating the camera. So first we also need the camera for this one. So to get the camera, there's only one type of camera. Click Shift A and select camera. Okay, the camera has appeared over here. So go to the location settings of it, the camera, and change its X to 90, the Y to 0, and the Z to also 90. And maybe, basically move this around so that when you look it up, you can also change the Z axis of it. So when you look at it up, you can see the volcano view. So basically, you can also put Z to top view and G to move the camera like this. Okay, so move it like this. Okay, if you want to, and you can click on 0 to see from the camera view. So this is the basic view, but we are also going to be editing it by a lot. So I'm just going to move it back, move it a little bit up, and I'm trying to just move it and make it this basic to basically make it like this version. So when we're going to rendering it, only this part is going to be rendered, the extra part is not going to be rendered, so don't focus on that. So and I think this looks good enough. So we can also animate the camera by using keyframes. Here we're just going to be adding keyframes on its location, not on its rotation. So click, hover your mouse over it and click on I on while you're on frame 1 and you have added one keyframe. So on frame, let's just say 100, and this will go 100. I actually want it to rise above like this. And then I'm going to click on I to add another keyframe. Then I'm just going to go to frame 180. And I actually want it to move a lot closer, and then move it downward. And maybe move it a lot closer. Basically, just these X, these lights where the lights are at that point. And then click on I again. So when we place animation, as you can see, scene's moving. The FPS is kind of slow because there's a lot of subdivisions, and yeah, this is going to be our animation. So the camera is like moving close to it, and in the end it just feels there to see everything. So now that we're done with the camera animation, we're going to be creating the materials for everything. So for creating materials, let me just bring back my sky. So let's just start with the sky, and then we'll start moving to other things. Click on sky, okay, and then click on this sheeting tab. Basically, this makes it a lot easier to create materials for it. And remember, these materials aren't exactly how it's going to be rendered. Keep checking, going back to the layer tab, and then click on render view to see what really they look like. So, okay, so let's go on the sheeting tab. We have the sky selected. Delete this principal BSDF, and before we continue, everything that we're going to create, one of those things, whatever we create, it needs to plug into either surface volume or displacement to actually give a result. If whatever we create over here doesn't plug into this one or this output tab, so it won't matter at all. Okay, so we can get almost every node by going Shift A, just like how we click Shift A over here to get meshes or etc. We can also get nodes by clicking on Shift A and then searching it. So we're going to be using search option for everything, because again, if we actually start doing it the other way, it's going to be a lot time consuming. So click on Shift A, search emission. Emission is basically light, because we want it to emit and not be affected by other lights. That's why we're going to be emission shader leave the value to 1, and we also want color ramp. Okay, and we perhaps want a color ramp. Usually the yellow dot goes to the yellow dot, the red goes to the gray, and a blue will go to the blue, but there are a lot of times there are going to be exceptions for it, so just select it for the hair right now. And because it was an evening scene, I want it to be like this dark bluish sort of color. Let's just swap these two. Okay, because we wanted a gradient effect. Okay, so and I also wanted the sun rays to be shown, so that's why I'm going to give it this orange sort of field, but it's not exactly on this right place where how we want it. So to control where we want the gradient to show up, we're going to be adding a mapping node. Basically, whenever you want to control the position of the material, you're going to be using these two nodes, mapping node and texture coordinate, and click on generate and make it select the draw vector. And then we also want it to move on the z-axis specifically. So shift A, click on separate XYZ. These are the names of the nodes that we're using. So if you're having trouble, just look at these names and names, and then you can search them for yourself. So plug in Z because I wanted to move on Z, and look, now it's automatically looking starting to look like that how we wanted it. Let me just show you. See, like this. You can change it depending on how you like it. Again, it's free creativity. So the next thing that I want to do is create the windows. Okay, the windows of the station. So the first thing you need to know is that in the EV render engine, we are also going to be going on the EV render engine. Okay, you can change the render samples, but 64 is pretty fine for this one. You also need to turn on ambient occlusion, bloom, screen space reflections, and also turn on refraction. And yes, so now if you actually want to, if you have a material that is semi-transparent like windows or glass or water, etc. But for water, we are not going to be changing the blend mode. So you can change the blend mode to something that works. Alpha clip is basically when you want it to be completely, when you want the transparent part to be completely cut off. Alpha hashed is when you actually want a little bit of blending. And alpha band is actually pretty good for this sort of things. So we are going to be going with alpha band for the blend mode. And the shadow mode is going to be alpha clip, because we don't want it to create any shadows. And also turn on screen and reflection for this one. And the principal BLG shader is actually pretty good for creating any sort of a lot of materials. So we create the principal BLG of the white color. Okay, and now I'm just going to go through the settings that we are going to be needing for this one. So make this material as is, remove the roughness completely, change the keep the clipper reference as it is, and make the transmission into 0.736. Okay, and now let's just because this is sort of a different material, I actually want to see it in the layout. And now, as you can see, the final render, as you can see, it's actually transmitting properly. It's like we actually wanted to, like so over here, because we don't want it completely transparent. We actually want it to be semi-transparent, like there's glass over here to give it a feel of it. Okay, so let's just keep on here to see the render again and push for accelerate solid mode. So this was the window material. Now the next material that we're going to be doing is the roof of the station. Okay, if you actually missed the settings, these are the basic settings. So the next material we're going to be doing is the roof. Click on the roof, keep the principal BSDF, and I think all of the settings are still going to be the same. Click on shift A, add in a color ramp. Tap the color ramp into the base color and change this. Click on this white prong over here. Okay, this is how you select the white prong and change it to red. About this material, and the black part stays black. Now, we're going to be creating the baby sort of part. So, for that, we're going to be using the wave texture. And again, for this one, we're also going to be needing to control the positioning of the texture. So again, we're going to be needing a space such separate XYZ. Okay, and again, because we need to keep its position, we are also going to be needing the mapping node and texture coordinate node. So make the generated onto the vector, we are going to be using generated most of the times, but there are going to be times when we're going to be using the other settings. We're going to be using the object one later on. Okay, but I think for these materials, only generated object is going to be used at best. And plug in the Y into the vector. Okay, this is one of those rare exceptions where a gray node is joining with the blue node. Okay, and it still works because if it didn't, it will turn purple-ish in the color. And now, as you can see, the waves have been created. If I didn't add a separate XYZ node, then you can see that the waves are created on the wrong place. We actually don't want them, we actually want them to be created on the Y, so that's why we're moving them for Y. You can also adjust some of the settings if you want to. Okay, like on the Y, I actually want it to be -0.1. You can also, we're also going to be changing the wave textures. So instead of bands, change it to rings. And instead of sign, change it to saw. So this is how I created the wave effect. You can also actually make this a little bit more thinner if you actually move the color ramp, but I actually like it about over here. So now that the group is created, let's click on the text. Okay, this was supposed to be a principal BSF. It's going to be a simple emission shader. Okay, change it from over here. You can easily change it to an emission shader. And it's not going to be it's going to be 5, and it's going to be a bluish sort of color to give it that neon sort of effect. You can also increase it to about 10, looks a lot more better. It is okay. So the next is the prong material. So the prong material is we're just going to be editing the principal BSDF. Make it first change the color to pure white. The intelligence should be 0.1 because we actually want it to be like a painted sort of effect. The roughness should be 0.1. Make the sheen 0.444. Change the clear pore to 0.7. And reduce the clear pore, keep the clear pore roughness. And I think those are the settings because I didn't want it to look that much different. And now we're going to be doing the base, this base over here. So the base is going to be pretty simple as well. Keep the default settings as it is of the principal BSDF. And now Shift A, color ramp. Add in the color ramp with the color of the base color, yellow to yellow. And add the Shift A, noise texture. And plug in the color yellow into the gray, and it was one of those exception parts. And I think we're going to be keeping the default values. Now the color ramp change the white to about switch these two out and make the black part instead of black a grayish sort of color. So this way you're actually getting show you from the other part like a cementy sort of look. But our lights are sort of faded out because we have it in rendered mode. So basically, it's giving us a cemented sort of look. So the next material is going to be the C. Click on the C. And usually, people actually change the blend mode. Okay, but I'm not going to do that because it doesn't care for that bit of reflection. So I'm just going to be keeping the defaults. So we'll start off by changing up the principal BSDF. We actually want it to shine, so we're going to turn the red to 0.1, specular to all the way up, specular tint all the way up, roughness all the way down. You can see that it's starting to affect sheen all the way up, sheen tint all the way up, clear core roughness to 0, IQR to 1.33. The value of 1.33 is actually the actual IQR of water. In fact, so whenever you're going to be treating a water material, stylized or not, you are going to be using this and make it transmission. Now we also because it is NPR, Shift A, color ramp, change it to this sort of seish bluish type of color, like light, and the dark one should be a little bit of dark blue. And then plug it in. Now the next part is actually complicated, so I'm just going to create the nodes because again explaining them I guess at this level you won't understand it. So basically, but I'll just give it to Abo. So we're just going to be using this MixRGB node. This is used for a lot of the NPR stuff, stylized stuff that people use. You'll see later on if you actually still keep on learning. You can also mix textures. So we're going to be mixing two textures. It's noise texture and Voronoi texture. Voronoi is used by a lot of patterns, and we also need to control its location. Okay, like I said before, we will be using mapping mode and texture coded, but the difference this time is going to be, I told you before that we will be using the object one as well. So this one is going to be using an object. So it's going to be object with a vector, and the object is going to be this empty. So this empty is a it's called empty001. So over here, after you create the object node, select type in empty, okay, and select the empty001. For me, it's empty001. For you, it's probably something else, maybe it's the same. Select it. This way, the rotation of the empty is going to be changing the textures or the material as well. So now, also change the Voronoi from 3D to 4D, and change it from F1 to distance to edge, okay. And the noise texture is actually going to remain the same, and the vector of this is going to be connected to the vector of both of them, and both the distance is going to be the color of the mix, and the vector of noise texture is going to be connected to the color of the mixture. Okay, as you don't see like this, so our water material is ready. Let's go back to the layout and render view. Okay, you can see that it's actually starting to reflect a bit. I think if you actually want to go a little bit over, turn on screen space reflection. Let's see how that works. Let's see it from the camera side. It's not working that well, so move it. And you know, you can see those light effect reflecting, bouncing. So that's really starting to work better. Let's go back into the shading tab. So the next thing that we're going to be doing is the smoke of the volcano. Click on the smoke. So it's going to be fairly simple material. Creative principle, PSCF, Shift A, mix shader. Simple mix shader, not the other one. Connect it with the surface. Add in emission, because I don't want the it to interact with others. So connect emission to the upper shader. Then we're going to be changing the blend mode for this one. So change the blend mode. Okay, over in the side tab to alpha blend, and shadow mode to alpha clip. Just change them, and shift A and transparent. Okay, it's transparent. You don't accidentally select the transparent one, so click on transparent and then add it to this one. Add the color ramp. Basically, we are going to be using the color ramp to control the how much of which thing is going to be visible. Is it going to be the emission shader that's going to be showing more, or the transparent shader? We're also going to be adding noise texture. Connect the color into the vector over here, and also need to make its position part a little bit. So click on the mapping and our texture coordinate. Again, we're going to be using the object coordinate this time again, and here, and again select the empty001. Empty001, this big bad empty. So you can actually, you're going to have to tweak the settings because again the smoke is different for me and it's going to be different for you. Now the next thing is going to be the volcano. The volcano is again the simple base material. We're just going to be editing it. Make the base material a little bit of this lightish orangish type of color, and make the subsurface color a lot of you this dark orange color, and make the subsurface 0.33. So reduce the specular all the way down, increase the roughness to all the way up, and make all the other values go back to 0 as well. Okay, the eye towards will stay the same if you want to. X2 is the next material that we're going to be doing. the text 2 was used for this part. So the text 2 is actually just a plain red color. That's it. That's totally what I did. After that, it's going to be road. Now, this isn't actually a material, it's going to be a texture. So, let's go back into the layout tab. Okay, I'm actually going to hide the environment because we don't need it. Okay, so click on 7 to go to top view. We're going to be using a texture, it's going to be the road texture. Okay, first of all, select it and select the road. Then go into the shader editor over here. Okay, click on this menu and then go into shader editor and then click on shift A, search IMAG image texture and connect the color into the color of this and then open up the road texture. I think it's for the name road. So I'll just go into my desktop. Yes, it's called road. Okay, so now the texture is connected and we're just going to be changing a little bit of settings over here. So reduce the specular to about 0.36, make the roughness all the way go up and the sheen tint go a little bit down about I guess 0.3 something. That's it. Now go back into viewport and click on UV editor. Okay, so when you click on UV editor, the road texture has appeared and this view. You can see the model. So click on 7 to go to top view. While having this selected, tap to come out of edit mode, go into modifiers and we had the mirror modifier, so now apply it. Click tab in again and now make sure that only this road part, okay, not the extra sides, just this road part is selected and go to 7 to top view and then click on U, okay, while being in this road view, while your mouse is in this view, click on U and then click on project from view bounds. So now we have the texture exactly on the shape of how we actually want it. So we can use the old techniques like similar techniques like B to box select, C to select these parts. So we'll just adjust the G texture over here. Let me just click on the material preview. So you, as you can see, that it's not looking red rubber. As I am going to adjust it, it's just going to be changing as well. So first of all, I'm just going to go ahead and click B in box select and then scale it like, oh, I think I have proportional editing turned on, so click on auto turn off proportional editing, scale like this to scale it on the Y, okay, also on the X, deselect it, B box select to select these parts again, G and Y to move it above. Now this texture is actually on the 2D plane, so only X and Y plane exist, third plane does not exist, so S and X again. And as you can see, the texture is automatically adjusting itself over here to be proper. Select everything. I think the upper part again needs to be adjusted a little bit more. Scale it. Feel free to zoom in. You select everything. B to box select just this lower part. G and Y to move it above about here. Okay. So as you can see, the texture is automatically adjusting itself the same on the other side. You select everything. B to box select. G and Y again, and as you can see, when I move it, the texture moves over here as well. G to Y and move it like this. This kind of thing. This is actually really basic. Texturing usually takes a lot of time, but I actually just did an easier way. If you guys want, I can create a tutorial how to create this texture, how I created it. I created it in Inkscape, so and then scale it like so, and I think we. I think we are done over here. So this is how basically just adjust the these UV and wraps to the shape of the texture. So then you can actually get this shape. Okay, tap to come out of edit mode. Let's go back into layout. Let's just go to edit mode. As you can see, that it's pretty much done. Also, I think these lights are pretty dull. I don't know which one of these was the real light. This one was a real light because it reflected color. I don't know why their light seems so dull, so let's just give it a boost and now we're just going to bring back the environment. Let's just click on 0 to go into camera view that rendered and you can see everything is starting to piece together nicely. What's the next material? I think the next material is the lights of the light poles. Go back to solid mode, go back into shading. Click on one of these light poles I think this is the correction change, this is the river. So just change the strength of the emissions for the light modern one, okay, to 5, that's it. I'm just doing a simple thing. And the light pole, we're going to be editing this one a little bit of it. So the light pole is, change the base color to this grayish sort of color, okay, because they're sort of pole. And metallicness to 0.6, not all the way shiny, just 0.6. Make the roughness go up as well, like 0.7. And I think that's about it for the light pole, because again it was supposed to be a basic material. So we're done with the materials and the texture. The base road one, this was actually a texture. This is actually a texture, and this is a material. I think I didn't do this one properly. Yeah, I didn't do this properly, as you can see. It's actually starting to look a little bit weird. So let's go back into material preview. I'll go back into UV editing. So why is it looking weird? Just because this is not, these things aren't placed properly. Visual box select. Oh, deselect everything. Visual box select. And yes, now they look about now. Yes, now they look actually not better. So texturing is basically like how you apply a cloth or batch it onto it. And this is actually the simplest form, because it's only one flat surface, so you actually get it pretty easily. And so now let's just go to camera view. As you can see, the rendered view, it's all coming, it all has come together. So now we're just going to be discussing the rendering part. So there are two ways that you can render it. Make sure that you are in the EV render engine and the settings are turned on, reflection as well, and after etc. So these things are turned on, and the render, this is how the quality is tested. On EV 64 or 80 is pretty good, and you don't need to go above 80, I think. But for guys, if you have something really really complicated, then maybe you can, but I don't think for this one we need to go above 80. So if you want, go to 80. Okay, so these are the server samples. So now to render this out, there are two ways. You can actually directly render it out as a video, or you can render it out as PNG images, and then later you can actually combine those images. So for me, actually, I think the rendering it as PNG images first is better, because if there is some sort of mistake, like for in like 10 frames, you can easily go into Photoshop and then edit those 10 frames. But if it's there are mistake in the video, you're going to have to re-render everything also from the start, and video editing is actually really hard. And the second advantage of rendering it as a PNG image is that, for example, let's say your system crashed or something like that. If you have like 60 frames rendered out, though, you still have those 60 frames rendered. Okay, that's the advantage of rendering a PNG image. But if you had, if you were rendering it as a video file, then those 60 frames are lost. You actually lost all of your progress. So for those people who don't have a good system, I think PNG rendering is actually really good for you. So let's just get started. First, I'm going to show you how to render it as a video file, and then I'm going to show you how to render it as PNG images and combine those images. So the FPS is going to be 24, that means 24 frames per second, and total frames are 240, that means this is a 10-second animation. Okay, so in the output tab, first select this tab. Okay, it's called the output properties tab. Click on this output tab. The resolution is going to be 1080. You can set a different resolution if you want to, but this is standard HD, so I think that should be how it should be. So yeah, so first of all, in the output tab, select where you actually want the rendered file to go of the images videos. Make sure for this tutorial, I guess you should create a new folder somewhere, okay, and make sure that it's empty. Okay, so I have this MetRender tutorial folder created. So I'll just select this and then name whatever you want to render. So I'll just select a new render. Okay, and then click on accept. This is going to be the name of my file. Click on accept. Once you have accepted, let's go down. Change this file format from PNG to FFmpeg. Now you can see that this is a new option called encoding. Select this, and this is there are going to be more options over here. So change the container from your score, whatever it's called, to MPEG-4. Then go down, and in the video section, because we don't have audio, we're not going to be touching this over here. In the video section, in the video project, change this to again MPEG-4 DMX, and the output quality should be constant bitrate, because I've seen it if you have emission shader on, the other qualities are don't work as well. So concentrated is the best one. Click on concentrated. All the others are pretty fine for now. And then click on render animation, and then you'll actually, after it starts running, you'll actually have a video file like this. Well, actually not like this, because the video file, as I told you before, isn't actually as good as the PNGs. This one was created by first doing creating PNG images, and then I actually combined them. So now I'm just going to show you the second method. For the second method, again, make sure that you have an empty folder, okay? Because it's going to be creating a lot of image files when you're done running, like this folder here, okay? This is a lot of, this is from my preview render, okay? So a lot of image files will be created like this. So first select the destination, then just simply change this to PNG, okay, and then click on render animation. Then you'll have a lot of images like over here, and that's why I'm saying you need to have a separate folder, because we're going to be combining all of those images, and if there are other images in the folder, then they're also going to be involved, and it's just going to be problematic for you. So after you're done rendering those images, click on this plus sign up over here, click on video editing, and then go into video editing. Okay, and then make sure that the frames are same as your frame flow of your animation. Okay, so in this case it already has 240 frames. Click on add, click on image sequence, and then navigate to wherever your rendered frames are there. For me it was on desktop. Then click on K to select all of this. This is why I told you to make a new folder, because you don't want any extra images files to be there. So I have some extra images, that's why I'm not going to be taking it. So when you click add image script, they're going to be added over here. And after that, you can change the settings again from PNG to FFmpeg, like I showed you before, from in the encoding, changing your SCART to MPEG-4, change the video codec to MP4 DivX, change the quality to concentrated, and then click on render animation. And like I said before, rendering PNG frames is actually more advantageous, because again, nothing can be lost, you have a lot more to gain, and initial frames are created, yeah, I guess it's a waste of space, because we're going to have to delete this when we have the video file. But like I said before, the quality isn't lost, it's actually a lot better in quality. If I rendered it directly as an animation, it wouldn't look this good. So I hope you guys learned something today. Please leave a like, subscribe to our channel, and I'll see you next time. Goodbye.